Okay, you've seen the title, you've seen the duration, so let's not waste any time. Leave the gun, take the cannoli, and let's go. Hi, this is the Epicurean Stoic, and welcome back to the last in this bunch of videos that trace ancient Greek theatre, history and poetry elements in modern popular culture. And given that this is the series finale, we're going all out, so join me and let's see together how 1972's The Godfather is the most tragic modern film in the ancient Greek sense. For starters, let me say that I am planning a series that will cover the story of how theatre came to be in ancient Greece, going over societal, psychological, historical and philosophical aspects of ancient Greek theatre in a lot of detail, so watch out for that sometime this summer. Now let's establish some quick foundations about ancient Greek tragedy. Tragedy emerged in Athens during the late 6th century BC going into the 5th, when there was a perfect storm of circumstances for it to develop. For now, let's just say that this is called the moment of tragedy, when people viewed human actions as stemming from divine power and did not consider themselves autonomous enough, yet were still able to reflect and even debate about said actions, searching for the meaning of an order that is beyond man and escapes him. There are, of course, structural elements that tragedy is known for, like the number of actors, their interaction with the chorus, etc., but there's no point trying to see if The Godfather has any of those elements, so I'll focus on the other big trademarks of ancient Greek tragedy. Firstly, tragedy involves change, as all good stories do, and if the audience is to connect emotionally to the story, tragedy needs a tragic hero. The tragic hero is the protagonist who possesses at least some amiable qualities, they shouldn't be all bad, but more crucially also a tragic flaw, they shouldn't be all good, lest the story be completely not engaging. A tragic flaw, though, is not just your garden variety flaw, it has to be something that causes the protagonist to commit a fatal mistake, called amartia, that drives the action of the play in general. This pushes the tragic hero on the aforementioned path of change, which is preferably from good to bad fortune. This reversal of fate, the peripeteia, usually ends with anagnorisis, the recognition scene I've mentioned both in my WandaVision video and my Helen video. This scene has the potential to move the protagonist to a better fortune or to cement their bad one. Think of Oedipus, who realizes that he killed his father and had children with his mother, and then blinds himself. In The Godfather, the tragic hero is obviously Michael Corleone. He is the moral center of the story, and he is the character undergoing the change that is ideal for tragedy, as we said, from good to bad. As a small aside, Arthur Miller's play, Death of a Salesman, is pretty much the only widely accepted modern tragedy, transforming ancient Greek and Shakespearean tragedies for the 20th century. Arthur Miller said that the common man is as apt the subject for tragedy in its highest sense as kings were, referring to the well-known difference between ancient Greek tragic and comic characters. The former were high-born people like kings, princes and princesses, noblemen, etc., while the latter were typically common people. Arthur Miller really stood by his point, naming the protagonist of Death of a Salesman Willie Loman. Loman. Anyway, The Godfather does not follow Miller in this, since Michael Corleone is the youngest and most cherished son of Don Vito Corleone. Vito has built a criminal empire in New York by himself, embodying the American dream but operating outside the law. Michael, then, is in a sense a man of nobility, with the privileges and problems that come with that. His father wanted Michael to embody the lawful side of the American dream, to become a senator or a governor, and bring to his family clean power and clear their name from the mafia and crime associations. So here we have a young prince, if you will, whose dad has great aspirations for him, and he seems to have them as well. In every analysis of anything related to The Godfather, you'll see a mention of,
"That's my family, kid, it's not me."
And that's because the change is more poignant due to its improbability. Michael distances himself from his family. He's a veteran and a war hero, calm and measured compared to the Achilles-like impulses and rage of Sonny, and the lavish and pampered lifestyle of Fredo, his older brothers. His tragic flaw is precisely this calmness, which allows him to be cool-headed and not controlled by his emotions. It is what allows him to be at the wedding of his sister and tell Kay stories about his dad threatening people's lives, just brushing it all off with a, "That's my family, Kay, that's not me." How does that bring his downfall, though? Well, after the shooting of his father, which he only learns about from reading the newspaper, he goes to the hospital, knowing that it is only up to him to protect him and that he would do anything for him. Where does all this come from? Well, apart from his calm distance and strategic character, Michael also agrees with parts of what his family stands for, of course. They don't make promises they can't keep, they're always honest and loyal, they do their best to protect their family. Michael is also like that, and the choice of making him a soldier solidifies this. But now, his family is in grave danger. The head of the family, his father, is wounded and in serious risk for his life. The previously charming calmness now becomes a tactical advantage, as shown in his quick thinking of the room change and the hand in coat stand to scare the assassins away. Not only that, but he notices Enzo's hands shaking vigorously from the adrenaline rush afterwards, while his are as still as a lake in the morning. This is precisely why, when his family didn't need him, he was distant from them, because he could afford to be. But when they were in danger, Michael stepped in and took matters into his own hands. During all this, he's still level-headed, his measured and calculative character serve him during both times, as he retorts to his brother,
"It's not personal, son. It's strictly business."
The hospital scene is the beginning of his fall, with a hint of anagnorisis. He realizes what he is capable of, and where this journey will lead him. From there, though, he steadily descends, always exercising his agency. His strategic thinking gives him the solution that Sonny, Tom, and Clemenza couldn't find. He'll kill both Solozzo and the officer McCluskey in a restaurant, exploiting his own calm and timid image, which causes them to not suspect him. In hindsight, of course Michael was the only one to save the family with such a drastic measure, and yet when you first watch both the scene where Michael explains his plans and declares,
"Then I'll kill them both,"
and the actual restaurant scene, it hits hard. So what then? Is his arc done after this? A good man pushed to the point of murdering two people, one of them a police officer, by his love for his family? If it ended there, it would be a good dramatic arc indeed. But instead, Michael is safely transported to Sicily to hide and lay low for a while. There we see him reconnect to his roots. He realizes that what he liked about his family's way of life comes from their motherland, and this is reflected in his actions. He immediately starts acting like a local, as shown by the bold but traditional actions he takes towards marrying Apollonia. Then, after the wedding and when it seems that Michael is a fully integrated Sicilian, a car bomb that was meant for him kills her, and at the same time, his father back in the States agrees with the other families to allow for Michael's return. There, he meets Kay again, telling her that within 5 years the family business will be completely legitimate, all while working on strategies to completely eliminate all the other crime families, especially Don Barzini, who was the one behind the attack on his father. His fate and his turn to evil are cemented in one of the best scenes put to film ever, the baptism scene. The image of the baptism, an act of purification and receiving the Holy Spirit for the newborn, and of a similar purification and responsibility taking for the Godfather, is juxtaposed with the ruthless killings of members of the other families, and Michael's look says it all. His character is essentially the same, but he has changed drastically. His tragic flaw, which as an additional bonus was his amiable quality initially, brought about his own moral downfall, and now he can never be good again. He is a tragic hero. But the tragic hero is not the only identifier of Greek tragedy. According to Aristotle's Poetics, tragedy's job is, through the imitation of the actions of the characters, to elicit emotions in the audience, and through pity and fear, to effect relief to these and similar emotions. The Greek word for this relief is catharsis, the cleansing, as it were, of emotions in the audience as the play reaches its resolution, compared to the intensity of feelings throughout the action. A purification ritual, especially given that tragedy performances were part of a religious festival. This is important for the narrative structure of tragedies, since their plots have to be governed by laws of causation, each scene causing the next one and nothing happening out of nowhere and without a proper cause. In fact, Aristotle tells us explicitly that the ending must be inevitable for the proper cathartic resolution that is so distinct in tragedy. Inevitable is precisely the word we would use to describe Michael's arc, given his initial characterization and the decision he takes during the film. Now, is catharsis achieved or not? I think it is. Catharsis does not mean a happy ending. In fact, the opposite is true, since in many tragedies, the tragic hero ends up in a much worse place than they were in the beginning of the story. Catharsis is more about the feeling of closure rather than the joyous ending, and it is implemented very powerfully in The Godfather. The story the film wants to tell is that of the corruption of a seemingly virtuous man under the extraordinary circumstances he finds himself in, and after the baptism scene, Michael has become the new Don and treated as such by his cabos. Kay looks at him mere minutes after he convincingly told her he had not ordered his sister's husband to be killed, and she realizes that not only is he lying, but that he is not at all the virtuous man she fell in love with in the beginning. Then, the door closes. And even this famous door closing is set up earlier in the film to enhance the eventual closure. In the end, we leave the film feeling complete, despite feeling pity and fear for many characters throughout, especially because of the inevitability of Michael's descent, so catharsis is definitely achieved. The final proper element or feature of a story that makes it tragic is thematic. Now, ancient Greek tragedies have different themes from each other, and every one of them has multiple themes brought up during debates, laments, reveals, and vengeful acts, but what I mean by theme here is a more general outlook of the world. The notion of fate, a predetermined set of events that await all of us and which no one can outrun, is central to ancient Greek tragedy. Reflecting the psychological state I mentioned at the beginning of the video, about humans trying to grasp with the fact that we have free will in a universe controlled by powers beyond us, tragedy centers around the clash between two sets of rules. Sometimes this manifests in the individual versus the societal rules, as we see in Aeschylus's Orestia trilogy. In the first tragedy, called Agamemnon, Clytemnestra decides to murder her husband, Agamemnon, due to him sacrificing their daughter Iphigenia, something I covered in my last video. But the point is that she goes for her personal rules, her urge for vengeance, against the rules of her society. This theme continues in the next tragedy of the trilogy, Hoifori, the Libation Bearers, where Electra and Orestes, Clytemnestra's and Agamemnon's other children, plot against and kill Clytemnestra for killing their father, but by the end, when the Erinyes, the Furies, start chasing Orestes for his matricide, it is clear that the two sets of rules are the individual versus the cosmic ones, the natural, religious laws. The resolution comes in the third tragedy, the Eumenides, where the concepts of the rule of law, trials, etc. are introduced by an Athena ex machina, going back to the individual versus societal rules, but with the societal ones prevailing this time. But, just like with the Libation Bearers, many tragedies focus on this tension between physis and nomos, the natural slash religious law versus the human, political one. The obvious example here is Antigone, where the state declares that one of her brothers should not be buried, but her personal slash religious principles push her to disobey the political laws and bury him anyway. How does this apply to the Godfather? In all the ways I discussed above, I would say, which is why I really wanted to make this video. First of all, we have a man versus society aspect, since Michael initially is an outsider to his immediate surroundings, his family, with a sharp contrast between their morals and their behavior. But when he comes closer to his family, he becomes more of an outsider to the wider American society, reinforcing his quote-unquote Italian ways and rejecting the laws of the land. There's a lot more going on here, though. The physis versus nomos divide also plays a role, with the prevailing of the raw human nature of wanting to protect one's family at all costs and take revenge for the injuries inflicted by others, against the still human but more rational and impersonal laws and political structures of the society the Corleone family lives in. Most importantly though, fate and its effects are omnipresent in the film. You might find that paradoxical, given that notions of fate in the Greek sense are completely absent from our modern sensitivities, and yet the Godfather is full of them, they're just disguised. The notion of a supernaturally predetermined order of the world is completely antithetical to the modern society, so fate has taken a different form in the film. It is the actions of people we do not see, actions which are imposed on our protagonist and which force him to act in specific ways. Vito's shooters are essentially nobodies, we barely see them or learn their names, and we only learn who is behind this too late for it to matter. But this is the catalyst for Michael's fall. Similarly, Michael's actions are always forced by external factors, even when he exerts his own agency. The impossible situation he's put in combination with his character and tragic flaw, are what drive him to the restaurant killings, so in a sense, he's not the one making the decisions. He's just swept along by an external force, fate. This is most prominent to me in the final moments we see of him in Sicily. Michael comes to love it there so much that he's planning to move to Syracuse with his wife Apollonia, fully intending to leave his past life behind him, along with any associations of mafia families and that dark side of his. But then, another anonymous intervention of an external force. His wife is killed by a bomb in his car. Michael has no choice again, he goes back to the States, and with Sonny dead, another event completely out of his control, he's the only choice for the new head of the family, since Vito is old and weak. All of these extraneous circumstances are the equivalent of the circumstances that push the tragic characters into their fated ends in the ancient Greek tragedies, and this is why The Godfather ticks this box too. Finally, and I know this video is long already, we have the question of the combination. In the best tragic stories, all these key elements, character, narrative, and thematic ones, work together seamlessly, with a tragic flaw which brings the protagonist's fall, being connected to the central tension between the individual versus the world, and so the anagnorisis is often what brings the catharsis. In The Godfather, the anagnorisis is spread out throughout the film, in subtle moments and with understated yet superb acting by Al Pacino, but there's no question, they all lead to the inevitable ending which brings catharsis. And then, as an added bonus, All of these elements, along with many other ones such as the aesthetic of both the locations and the film itself, the soundtrack, etc., perform a very delicately choreographed dance, an impeccable interplay with the concept of fate we just covered, to give a very distinct tone and feel to the film. This is exactly the same feel I get every time I see a well-made and well-adapted performance of an ancient Greek tragedy, something I don't seem to get when I see, for example, Shakespearean tragedies and modern films adapted from them, so it drives this thought in my head even deeper. The Godfather is the quintessential modern tragedy. Thank you for watching this video, and the series as a whole. I will take a short break over the next couple of weeks, as I need some time to finish the last university deadlines and exams and work on the next two series. The first one will cover the birth of philosophy and its journey down to the Epicureans and Stoics, for obvious reasons, and these videos will be coming out every Tuesday. At the same time, every Friday, I will be uploading videos in a new series about the path to democracy in ancient Athens. I'm totally spoiling you with content, so make sure to press like and subscribe to be there when it comes. Until then, have a good time and remember, seek virtue.